All right, ladies and gentlemen, let's bring it back to break. Good news is we have less than 70 minutes since lunchtime. 17, no. All right, ladies and gentlemen. Now, over the last few years, it's probably been in works for about 6 or 7 years, College Board has revamped and rewritten all the AP history courses. And that's from input from, how does this mean, what does this mean to you guys? Because it's input from the colleges. What do the colleges want their freshman students to understand and be able to do? And if you look at this is basically the paper we gave you, the pink one, you know, so we could be bright, is that we're looking at these historical thinking skills. The colleges asked that these freshmen come in with the ability to think like a historian, which goes into a lot of the things about what Scott said earlier about, you know, how to look at credible sources, understand that there are two sides to every event, historiography. What we focus on are these four key thinking skills. They're listed at the bottom. They were six. There's actually more. There was actually synthesis and periodization, but they've actually said, okay, that's almost overwhelming for a student. So they've gone to these four basic skills. And I'm going to tell you, there's going to be some ones that are seem easy to come right into your curriculum, and there's going to be some that are going to be, okay, that may not fit very well, or I may not be able to do that at a high level because it's just not meant for that. But we'll take a look. The first one we're going to look at is one that they should be able to do when they come to you, I would hope, is comparison. Remember the compare and contrast. This is real simple. How are things the same? How are things different? The important thing that we want kids to understand and that you can help them with is that when they're doing something that's comparison, that they do give you what is the same, what is different. A lot of kids will say, well, it's compare, it's just different. Here's why it's different. That's not going to be enough. We actually want them to start thinking like a historian. How are they the same? How are they different? This is something that obviously geography, we're talking about historical skills, we think we're going to lose you, but you guys can do compare and contrast with the best of them. I mean, it is the easiest. And then, again, if we're in a seventh grade curriculum, what are you looking at that's easy to compare? We're talking about Texas, physical geography. Is there a compare and contrast with the state of Texas? I was informed that there's not just a piney woods, there's a morning thicket. What is it called?
It's a big thicket.
Big thicket, sorry. What a sexy. My partner is obviously from Silsbee, Texas, so she knows about the big thicket. And I did mistakenly call it the piney woods one time, and I got, I don't make that mistake anymore. Eighth grade, you can, again, compare and contrast. These are easy things. I don't want to belabor, but if I'm just thinking about the eighth grade curriculum, which I taught way back when in HISD, you know, you can compare the compromises. I mean, once you get the second, you know, compromise of 1850, how do we compare that to the compromise of 1820? You go backwards in history and bring it together and make that connection. And be surprised how that's going to help them with other thinking skills. Those are things that we want them to do. Eighth grade, obviously the easiest compare and contrast is going to be the three regions, the colonial regions. That's right off the bat. That's early. You guys get to that by week two, week three? Boom, compare and contrast. We're looking at South, Middle, and New England. How are we comparing those and what categories are we comparing? Again, how are they the same? How are they different? Any questions on comparison? Again, this is one of those things that the kids should come in with this as an easy concept. These are posters in my room, by the way, because I want to keep it in kid language.
And this is an easy thing for you as a teacher to incorporate into your classroom because it could involve just putting on a piece of paper, do a T-chart, you know, or list all of your similarities, list your differences, and then maybe have them write a couple of sentences with them. What I always struggle getting my kids to do is write one sentence listing a similarity. Both oranges and apples are fruit, and naming the things. You see, that's one of the biggest struggles. They don't actually name what they're saying. What they're talking about, they'll just use a pronoun. You know, training them to say both oranges and apples are fruit. while oranges are orange, apples come in many colors. You know, having them name it and put in specific things. It's not anything difficult. It's just training them to do that. My comparison activities that we do, I did the same comparison activity every time. If I printed it off, all I did was change the page number that I had in my directions. It became easy for me as a teacher, and my kids got really good at the skill, and it became second nature to them. And because it was, it might have been the same skill, the comparison, I didn't get the, oh, this is boring complaint, because it was something new. And you have the opportunity to give them some freedom, because it's not just what is the answer to number one. If they're comparing the three regions of colonies, they get to pick, you know, what things they want to call similar, what things they want to pick differently. And you can kind of give them opportunities for collaboration between your students where they can compare their own answers.
Again, if we want to tie this into other things we've done, this is easy graphic organizer stuff.
Thinking maps,
they are. Again, cause and effect, that's another thing. Again, these are what colleges have said they want their freshman students being able to do at a high level, at least at a very high level, average level, when they enter, when they step on campus. Understand why did it happen and what was the impact, cause and effect. Obviously, again, this should be another, I would say, thinking skill that would be easy for a student to get to understand, because it's one of those things, even in your lower levels, this is addressed, cause and effect. These are the two that I would think at the 7th, 8th, and 9th grade level you could easily do throughout the year. I mean, I hope you guys would agree with me on that. I mean, I'm not opening up Pandora's box and saying, there it is, go get it. You guys have never seen this before. This is, again, I would hope that this seems, oh, that's not too hard. I hope you can automatically come up with cause and effect. Causes of the Civil War, I was the deeper. again, things like that.
Cause and effect, a way that you could differentiate between level classes or pre-AP classes. You know, list your cause and effect maybe for a level, but then build up for your pre-AP to analyzing those effects. Was it long-term, short-term? Was it a negative, a positive? You know, going a little bit more deeply into that.
Okay. Any questions on cause and effect? You know, these are things that when we put them up there, I'm like, okay, an experienced teacher, anybody that's been through high school, these two skills should be relatively easy. And it's when you address it like this, and you start talking like, we're thinking like a historian. When I taught in 9th grade, I was like, guys, I call them geographers. We're geographers today. I do the same thing in my class. Okay, historians, let's talk about this. We're going to think like a historian. A little more difficult skill that you may have a harder time in a restricted curriculum in 9th grade might even have even, I'm not going to say impossible, but you'd have to go outside the box to do change over time. Continuity and change over time has to be over a time period. So if you're looking at the history curriculum for 7th grade, history curriculum for 8th grade, the scope and sequence, you really can't do this until you get some history in taught and some instruction in there. You can do it, but it may not be a skill that we really expect that to come out of 7th and 8th grade. But if it's introduced as in a discussion or thinking, if you ask them to think about this, what has stayed the same, what has changed, and why? These are the simple, common words. Everybody knows what I've just said. The big thing I always use is the change of American foreign policy from World War I through 9/11. Now, obviously, you do that lesson until I get to 9/11. But it's also possible, I mean, if you want to grab something that you know that they've had earlier, like as an 11th grade teacher, I can call on them and actually say, hey, I know the 8th grade teachers, they taught before the Civil War. You know what's, even when I'm not there yet, you know what's going to happen up to a point. Can you think that way? Again, this is a writing skill as much as it is a thinking skill. They're going to have to be asked to express and answer questions that are based on how did this event happen? How has this stayed the same? This broad topic stayed the same. How has it changed? And why? Again, with restricted curriculum, you're going to have to wait to get to the, at least half would be your curriculum to see if there's anything. Eighth grade, which is, I'm sorry, seventh grade teachers, I don't have a grasp on your curriculum. But there's so much, you have so much geography in there too, that makes it difficult. What could you change over time in eighth grade? Could you look at how slavery was viewed from colonial times to the 1850s? The view. How has the forming of abolition movement changed over time? How did it stay the same and how did it change over the time? Again, you're looking at that, now you're looking at the lead up in the Civil War. Does everybody make sense on that? And again, is this a skill we expect that you think you're gonna be able to do every day? No, this is gonna be one of those things where you explain it to them and actually ask them to make the connections from the past. This is all about connections. Thinking like a historian. And the last one we're gonna have you at least explain, at least think about, is contextualization. This is higher level stuff. I got a good contextualization for seventh grade teachers. You guys obviously teach the Alamo. Now I know the Alamo is more, there's more to Texas than the Alamo. But there's a song that said there wasn't for Texas, there wouldn't be an Alamo, right? You know, I heard that song. Biggest American hero to die at the Alamo? Davy Crockett. Why was Davy Crockett there?
By accident.
By accident, but why did he leave Congress? To go to Texas? Y'all can go to hell and go to Texas?
You got voted out.
It was the Indian Removal Act. His protest, the Indian Removal Act. Context is about how does this event fit into a bigger picture? How does this event, you know, influence another event? And at this point, Davy Crockett, protesting Indian removal, decides to leave Congress, he decided to leave and head to Texas. Well, still, y'all can go to hell and go to Texas. That's the Lord. Again, this is context. How does this fit in? Eighth grade, American Revolution, French Revolution. That's a context. You know, how does this fit into the bigger picture? Now, we don't want to go too far into that because the next skill is synthesis, and they took that out. And we don't, obviously, synthesis apparently was the hardest thing to do on this last AP U.S. history test. They took it out. But ultimately, contextualization. It's a bigger picture. And as Scott was saying earlier, a little bit of context skill would be helpful, especially when they're digesting the news of the day, especially the way they get the news of the day. Many of you were, when we were their age, I don't know how old you guys are, but you know, Tom Brokaw, Peter Jennings, Dan Rather, was, if I wanted information, that's how I got information.
Walter Cronkite.
I'm not that old. I'm a little offended by that. When I said Dan Rather, I hope you guys realize I wasn't that old, but okay.
I was.
Okay, well. Isn't there a beach somewhere you should be? No. But now you guys know how they get information today. It's in their hand, and it's from all kinds of different sources. If some are credible, some are not. Contextualization may help them from actually just going off the handle, making the, you know, understanding what's going on. Again, these are the skills, the forethinking skills that the colleges have said they want their freshmen to be able to do when they step on campus. Do we want them, when they step on campus at the high school level, to be able to do those four skills? Absolutely not. However, if you give them a taste of it, that's helpful. Any questions on this at all?
I know that writing was mentioned earlier, you know, talking about if they are going into dual credit U.S. history, that's probably the class that they will actually write the longest paper and have to do an actual research paper in, where they're not going to be asked to do that in AP U.S. or AP World History or pre-AP World Geo or pre-AP anything else we've got. That's definitely a college skill. But giving them some sort of writing is necessary, and grading writing sucks. I know. That's all that I do in AP seminar, honestly. I get 10-page research papers from these kids of terrible things half the time. But the kind of writing that we can build into the social studies classes, I think we need to strip away the idea that writing is a paragraph or longer and start focusing on getting them to write a coherent sentence, just making a statement that both the blank and the blank have this. While this does this, this does that. And because of this event, blank happened. You know, just getting them to write these as sentences. And what I would do a lot of times with my kids on activities, I would give them a graphic organizer or some kind of chart where they just fill in the chart with words, and the end activity is pick one cause of this event and write a sentence discussing the cause, write one sentence discussing the effect, and they already have the answer in front of them. It's just making them coherently write it. And as the year went on, we did move to paragraphs where if we did cause and effect, I had them describe the event, discuss the cause, discuss the effect, and I'd make them highlight in different colors. That's probably the best school supplies thing you can have. If you are going to incorporate writing, have them highlight, because when they do get to AP World and AP US History, I know if they do take those, the longer essays they will write, that are still just three-page handwritten essays maybe, 3 to 4, depending on the student. When they're teaching it, you can teach them to highlight your thesis in blue, highlight this point in pink, highlight these points in yellow, and it makes it easier on you as a teacher to grade it because you can kind of ignore the filling part if you need to, right? One of the things I always incorporated into my pre-AP classes, for those of you that will teach pre-AP, I did have short answer questions on my tests. I just gave them to them in advance, and they could prep it if they wanted to. And sometimes, I didn't grade them. They didn't. They thought they got it graded. It didn't get graded, but they still got in the habit of doing it. So, looking back over the notes that you've already taken when we were talking about the textbook discussion,